Nicely done. Perfect. We've already live streamed also. And thank you, Patricio, for coming in. I stopped you from saying anything because I wanted everything on record. You were going to say some very nice things. So I said,
don't worry. It's my pleasure, of course. And thank you for having me. Really, it's a remarkable initiative of your part in terms that you can, that we can meet virtually other candidates and other fellows that in other position, and particularly considering what happened in the world with COVID-19, it's almost impossible to meet presentially. So it's extremely remarkable initiative of your part.
No, it's been very nice. And everyone's responded so nicely. That's what I really liked, that everyone thought that, yes, it was a good idea. And they came in, and there's so many more which are going to come in. Because when I saw the list of the fellows, there's so many people I know out of this, and then I put it out and you contacted me and so many other people contacted me. So I think it's a very nice thing. Having conversations with wonderful people like you, that by itself is so nice. So
no, thanks for your part, of course. And it's really interesting that it's really an immense effort of your part that you're doing to collaborate with not only with JAMS Foundation and the Weinstein Foundation. It's about your commitment, your real commitment in terms of facts. No, it's about words with the ADR community worldwide. Something that is remarkable and must be recognized publicly.
Thank you very much. I mean, real kind words. This is what keeps me going. I'm telling you why. That's why I wanted you to put it here, because this is all it's all about. Having conversations with wonderful people, and you just out there, it's just a conversation. It's nothing else. But if that word spreads and we can have these conversations going out, and people in whatever way get inspired by some aspects that you would tell us, I think that is what it's all about. And like you said, it's...
Yes, it's extremely interesting because in my point of view, at least what I saw before, other colleagues that I have curious about who are, what they experience. Some of them I meet, for example, Mita Tita Narayan, it was my fellow and is a lovely person. It's for India also. And for example, Ivana Ninsic, I met him because we were in the same cohort in 2017. But this other person that I have no opportunity to meet. So it's a great opportunity. It's to see their experience, their words, and their appreciation about not only about the fellowship, about the mediation in their own countries. And it's, as I said before, it's something absolutely useful and completely necessary for today and for people interested in ADR, in general.
Because the interesting thing was that initially it was like they will discuss their experiences with the fellowship. But those conversations went out beyond that because of the fact that they were already looking at doing something in their countries. So that aspect came up, and from there, those as things about what they were doing, what they had planned to do, I think that is what made it more interesting. So that is why I think, well, I had a very nice conversation with Harbey from Colombia. We had a very nice conversation. I don't know whether you saw that. It was really nice. I mean, we spoke about so many things. We had similar views on a lot of aspects of, because I have some radical views, Patricio. you'll notice that.
Well, I believe when I hear Harry, it's really interesting. It's a very professional person, and it's a good experience in mediation. But in my point of view, I have a different point of view. I hear Harvey is strongly engaged in narrative theory of mediation, which in my country it's quite used. Because I'm working most of the time as a family mediator, and here in Chile, narrative mediation it's most used, particularly in family mediation, and it's extensively tested. Because I will explain you that to become a mediator, not you can be mediator compliant with some rules, but if you become a mediator contracted by the government or throughout a subcontract for the government, you must be apply and do a lot of tests, many tests, and to study. And this study implies a lot the use of, for example, the theories of mediation, and particularly narrative mediation. So it was really interesting how Harvey engaged was in this issue. If I'm not wrong, he was take lectures, or part of their scholarship was made in the George Mason University, where with Sarah Cobbs, which is the quintessentially exponent of narrative mediation. So it's really interesting. It was really, really interesting.
Because I have a lecture series, I'm going to ask him to come and give some lectures on narrative mediation also. And
yeah,
and you will give some lectures on some aspects of mediation. It's just, like I told you, that lecture series is to further inspire people who will never get a chance to go for a lecture about mediation. So I'm putting that out so that at least whatever, I mean, if that one person sitting in one corner of the world gets inspired and then moves into the field, and then who knows what the person is going to do. It can change things in the world. One person can change things in the world. So that's the thing. That's the idea.
Well, and here entering to the issue, I think that isn't this initiative, it's important because I remember one thing that one of the teachers that have a connection in the United States during the scholarship, it was Professor Jen Martinez. And she told me something really interesting, which is, it's important that you have a view. If you have a view about what you want to do for future, it's an advance. It's the start of not necessarily a career. It's about a project. So, and sometimes you're very seclusive about your thinking, about your ideas, and eventually you become as a prisoner of their own limits. And exactly. When you talk about it, when you hear other persons, there's something that makes sense about things that you cannot explain, or there is a part of the puzzle that you require to ending. And this is the valuable thing in my point of view. And in some degree, that's the thing that the fellowship made for you. Yeah. It's make you the opportunity to stay in contact presentially and physically and be engaged in something that you never have the option to do. And then you can catch or take in consideration issues, aspects, and other things that are important. And then you can apply it. Not necessarily copy everything, but something makes sense for you. And that's important. I think that's this point. And this kind of conversation, it's the idea. That's the idea. It's remarkable. And technology is a friend, it's not a foe.
Absolutely. Absolutely. What you've said right now is actually what I have been able to gather from the starting point when I got into this thing, that I got to know about the fellowship from Miglė, who's in Lithuania, in their other show that I do, In Conversation with the Beautiful Mind. So just struck me, okay, there is a fellowship like that. I see a LinkedIn post which says that the applications are invited. I see the list of people. I said, let's have these conversations. But what came out of this was exactly what you just said. Sometimes there are some thoughts that you have, and if you talk about them, even if you put them down on paper, once you, even people applying for the fellowship, then they start writing something out, their own thoughts become stronger in what they want to do. And then after that, how are they going to implement it? At least those thoughts start. So what I thought was, okay, fellowship is given to maybe about 10 people in the year. But what I'm doing now is that I'm putting it out that if you have a project that you have in mind and you want resources or whatever, get in touch. I'll try and put people together who can then help you take them forward. There's so many people around the world who would want to do interesting things. Let's give them an opportunity. So that's what's coming up, Patricio. That's what came out, a good thing that came out from this.
Well, in my experience, what happened, but if you prefer to talk about the application process, what then happened, or in general, the procedure, what happened then?
If what one thing, prefer? Let me tell Patricio, I'll tell you one thing. Once you notice from all the shows that I do, I have lots of time. So you can talk about everything.
it's very interesting, but how I became interested in the scholarship? Searching the internet, so simple like that. Mm-hmm. And they say, oh, this scholarship is interesting. But I'm starting to see it's interesting. And in general, in my country, it's not known new. In Latin America, it's new, but not so much. But JAMS it's a world-class, as you know, a world-class provider of ADR services, particularly in the United States. But the history, how I became engaged is, okay, I will write. I see and started to implement things that I was interested about. For example, I was my career, and I would set up a little bit about my background that may be helpful.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm starting in mediation in, well, my first interest was in 1997, when I take a course about techniques of mediation, of commercial mediation. And it was made by the Chamber of Commerce, or city we're living in Valparaiso. It's 1 hour close to Santiago, the capital of Chile. And well, it's really remarkable how the destiny is curious because this training was provided by one of the neutrals of JAMS, Dina Jansson. And so almost 21 years after that, I became a fellow. So wow. It's really curious. Yeah, really curious. So one of the lessons or one of the things that you can learn from this is, okay, maybe the result is not immediately. It's a long time. It takes time. It takes a force. So don't get desperate. Be patient, be consistent, and follow. Because when I started mediation was in 1997, the first course, then take over in 2001. But I became engaged really mediation in 2004 and 2005 when in a university where in the middle, of course, I started my professional career as a lawyer here in Chile and become engaged in cases, in different cases, particularly in family cases. But in 2005, started the reform of family law in Chile, who created family courts and created mediation. So here where the things started to become together, to juxtapone each to other. And that's the reason that became engaged in, to give a postgraduate course to prepare people for be mediators in 2005. And that was a big challenge because starting from zero, nothing, absolutely nothing. So no mediation, no mediators, unknowledge, in general, ignorance about what mediation is. And sorry. And it was, of course, interdisciplinary, where we're engaged psychologists, lawyers, medicals, physicians, and all together talking about, not only about mediation, about it was about family law, about mediation, and about intelligence, about the issue about Daniel Goleman, yeah? Mm-hmm. Emotional intelligence. It was interesting because we're trying to mix it up and we create this course, and then come the challenge that the people went to mediation were not compulsory, and it was a big effort, but I believe that it was successful because we achieved almost five cohorts, or five times we gave this postgraduate course, and we gained experience about to became engaged with the judiciary branch in terms of family law. So it's really interesting. And well, after that, the course stopped because for purposes of, particularly for reasons of some limitation in the budget, and also for more competition, and there were other courses that become more interesting for the people. But in general, it was successful. And after that, starting a career in mediation, mediating, of course, but the drama, it was you become mediator there, but mediation wasn't compulsory. And one lesson in general that we discovered in Chile and maybe applicable to other countries is when mediation, it's not compulsory, in particularly because this family law, it was paramount in our country because established by the first time a formal divorce, a real possibility to get divorced. And all the people go massively to get divorces. People were separated long time ago, but they needed it. And it was something a little bit like a fashion, something like a trendy, and all the people were ready to become divorced. In other words, the people really want to be consistent, legally consistent, their reality with their legal status. And that created really a huge amount of causes in mediation. Of the causes in family courts. And other issue important, it was because the people can present and set the files before the court without the use of lawyer. So it was worse. And this create a mess for the family court from the judiciary branch, and was necessary to create and enact a reform of the family law, establishing that mediation must be compulsory in order to create a filter, yeah? And it was successful. It was successful in this issue. But more important, and here is one of the things that we'll talk about in a few minutes, it's that create a system where mediation will be financed by public resource. under a scheme of subcontracting. In other words, okay, the state does not give the service of mediation, but pay to privates that, for example, as a corporation or groups of persons or NGOs eventually can apply and then provide the service. We will pay this corporation to provide the service. And this established a really industry of mediation and consolidated the process. And it was quite interesting because it generates that all theoretical issues that we discussed a long time ago, it becomes applied to concrete terms and generate a mixture between theory and practice. And particularly the practice was determined particularly for administrative law and concretely by the department or for the group or the area of the Ministry of Justice who is in charge of mediation. So, and that's where mediation, at least family mediation, become consolidated in Chile. So nowadays it's, we are in the, maybe in the fifth process or the eighth process, we're a long term with mediation. Even this year ends one of the contracts and we start the new process to become mediators registered as a mediators contracted by the state. So it's a long process and for become, to be eligible, you must take a knowledge, a test of knowledge about theory of mediation, about legal or family law, for example, and all the laws engaged in family issues where mediation is applicable. Then you have to take a psychological test, which is the test that determine if you're able or you will have a profile able to be mediator. And then you have another test, which is give you more points, not compulsory, that allow you to compare your, under a simulation, what is your profile and if you fit with the competence system that define the best practice that a mediation, that a mediator in family law must have. So it's quite complex. It's not easy at all, really. And after that, then you can apply, you even can contract it, and eventually if the company or if the NGO where you work it with or yourself, you apply, are selected, you have the contract for 4 to 3 or 4 years. So it's very ordinated in this area. So it's very well structured, the system in family law, and it's many people interested to do so, and it's not bad paid.
How much do, what do they get like? If they do get onto the panel there, what, how much money do they get, these mediators?
Well, it's interesting because it changed also. For example, when I started mediation, the government pays you per agreement.
Okay.
If you reach an agreement, you receive a payment. For example, I would put, it depends because the how we're selected, you were, if you were selected, one of the issues that they consider is the offer that you made for each agreement. For example, I offer that you pay, I will receive $100 for one agreement, okay? If it's a complete agreement, if it's a partial agreement, $75. There is no agreement, only $10. So is, this is the issue, where is what they're meaning. And this generates something, a perverse effect, really perverse, because people become interested to reach agreements. Yeah, and it was very critical. For example, something that happened. Okay, we have two problems, and because it's interesting, because it's per agreement. So, for example, if you have a problem with custody and alimony child support, there are two issues, okay? So what is the issue? Okay, let's take, what is the theory of mediation says? Okay, let's regulate all together. So in concrete terms, what you achieve? One agreement, so $100 only. But Chileans are very shrewd in general, a little bit tricky. So what to say? Oh, well, it's interesting. So it's better. Let's talk first about child custody. Well, $100. And next week we have another session and then we can settle about the issue about alimony child support. So you receive $200.
Wow. Really? So people find a way out some way or the other.
Yes. And it happened. It was even more perverse because if you have a pool of mediators, yeah, if you have if you work at five mediators in one company, because it's selected by the jurisdiction of each family court. So if you have five mediators in the same group, the people start to fight for given more mediations. So it was a little bit mediators fighting for mediation. It's really sick, really. No, it was something sick. So after some cases, and this generated also other problem, which is you can gain a good money eventually. I'm talking about, for example, but it's variable because some mediators gain, for example, almost, $2,000 or win $3,000. Another win, for example, monthly $4,000 in this scheme, but you have to all the day start mediating all the day from Monday to eventually Friday, from 8 p.m. even to 9 p.m. all the day. And one mediation after another, 1 hour difference. So really it was a machine to make money and a machine to make mediations. And the critics was, we are more focused to create or to achieve mediations express. So after that, the government, and another problem was, we was not contracted under a labor scheme. We were constructed under a civil scheme. So we have no right, for example, for coverage of health, or we have no right to vacations, and we have no time, for example, to some limits about our time schedule. So after that, the government changed and decided to say, okay, guys, people, this is not the scheme. We prefer to focus on achieve more sustainable agreements. And that's important for administrative law. We are more interested that the people take your time before what thing it's going to decide and take time to sign the agreements. So nowadays you will be paid under labor scheme. So we are now, mediators are contracted as an employee. So you have right all the months, no matter how much mediations you do, you have the right to receive your payment. Yeah, you have your health coverage. If you get sick, you have a medical leave and it's paid. For example, you have coverage from the accident, for the accident insurance law. So we have a lot of benefits that previously you don't have. And above all, you are not fighting for your colleagues to give more mediation, something absolutely necessary. And it was a good change because with the pandemics, it was demonstrated that this system, in the human side, it was more important because avoided that many mediators become almost in poverty, not receiving nothing. Yeah. So it was very interesting, this change. So in my experience, what I can share with you and our other viewers is when mediation becomes structured or become associated with the judicial branch and the state provide the funds, the administrative regulation of this contract is as much important as mediator itself, because in that way you can bring to practice many theories. So it's very sociological aspect of mediation in practice. So that's the thing that I can tell you.
Why I keep asking about what mediators get is because my focus is that finally, sometimes in the system of the judiciary wanting to promote mediation, the mediator gets lost somewhere. The mediator's interests get lost. So that's why I keep asking about the money part of it, is because I want to see that, has that, I say, like you said, now they are employees. So how much would they get in a month as employees of the government?
Well, now it's interesting because if you are employed, in some degree, because it's competitive, the state to decide if you are you win this competition for achieve or obtain one of the contracts, you must assume what is the cost of mediation and how much pay. Yeah, it depends because it's a correlation between the budget that the state have for the case and the theory and the group of persons that will work in this mediation, and how it's your offer. So that's a way. But in general, you can receive for one complete journey. When I say a complete journey, from 9 to 5, Monday to Friday, you can receive between $1,500 monthly, base, because they generate incentives. What are the incentives? For example, the basis of the basis of the contract say, okay, if you have an higher degree of agreements, you receive a bonus. So this is a basis that is added to your base payment. Okay, other is, okay, do you have, for example, a sustainability of agreement? So is this agreement is not reconducted or is no analyzed again in 3 months, you receive another bonus. So, and if you go to take test and this test is during the duration of the contract and you achieve good grades, is another bonus. So it's added.
Okay.
It's but in general, it's not bad paid. There's a, it's a good, it's a fierce competence to become a mediator because most of people is interested, not lawyers, because mediator in Chile, it's particularly in family law, and it's colonized by psychologists and social workers. And mediators, we are a minority.
Yeah, not bad. I think that interesting structure that has been created. I'm sure that's a good thing. But the only thing, look, I tell you what I struggle with always is, well, the parties pay nothing. You're saying the parties pay nothing. The state takes care of everything. That's how it is. The parties are not paying anything for the mediation.
No, the parties in terms of, to confirm, you're interested to know what is the role of the parties?
No, are they paying anything for the mediation or they're getting it for free?
No, in general, well, the parties do not pay general because, but let me, I understand. For example, the government pays to the mediator, but the parties do not pay. In general, most of our population enjoys of this mediation for free. Yeah, but it's for free for the parties, but it's paid for the mediation. But for example, if a higher executive of a big corporation comes to mediation and their income is $10,000, must pay.
Okay.
You must pay. Yeah. It's a minority.
Maybe.
It's like a 5% of the people who pay, really.
But how much would those 5% pay? How nominal would their charge be? How much will they pay for that?
There is a lot of parameters that set up if you pay or not. For example, your income, and we have in our country it's like call it the National Register of Homes, which is a register where the government has all your data about your social conditions. Yeah, this is used. For example, for the government to allot you or to give you subsidized benefits, and each person has allotted an average, a number of points, depending if you are, for example, older, if you have sick, if you have, for example, any kind of problems, you gain more points. The higher points, more benefits you achieve. The lower points, you achieve less benefits. So one of the issues that you get, because the Ministry of Justice has a system where you charge all mediation and you make the social analyze of the people if they apply to the for a free mediation. That's the issue. Yeah. But eventually, for example, if you are a member, if one person is a victim of family violence, it's free. It depends of the if you are benefits of a public system of health with a lower income, it's free. So it's very, there's a lot of issues. And all this part of all this job is supposedly due by the mediation, but usually it's made for the administrative persons who work in the center with you, which is one of the requirements that the government requests to apply to this service.
But it's interesting. A lot of thought has gone into it because I don't think too many countries have done this. So much thought and has gone into structuring it properly. But again, I'll come back to that one question again. If that executive with that income of $10,000 and has no other, he gets the lowest points, what is that person going to pay? I want to know that.
No, because they pay, but
How much would that be? I just want to know the figure.
How much do they pay?
Yeah.
For mediation?
Yeah.
Well, it's an interesting issue because here in Chile, family mediation, it's a product, I would say it's an ugly word, but it's necessary to say it's a service which is a fixed price, because the government says there each almost 1 year or almost 1.5 years, the government published in the official bulletin the maximum price to be paid for one session of mediation. Today, this price is for session $110 per session. Yeah. So here is another semantic issue to be considered. What is a session? Yeah, because one session, it's something a little bit describing, because there is some claims presented before the higher court, who is in charge of the roster of mediation, for example, where they say, okay, a session of mediation is 1 day, 1 hour. Yeah. So you pay 1 hour of mediation. Other people say, okay, one session is 1 day, but no matter how many hours are. So it's something that must be explained with the parties, yeah? But you cannot do, and this is something that is a jurisprudence set up for the court to say, okay, but you cannot say that two sessions can be made in a successive manner the same day. It must be separated 1 day for another day. There's something of the issue, because the idea is not to generate a case or an incentive in general to make mediations or to extend unnecessarily.
Because I'm looking at it from, look, of course, Chile is a small country in terms of population, about what, 19 million people. So of course, things are different. I mean, because from the Indian perspective, when I look at it here, definitely for the state, in general, I keep saying that should the state be funding people's disputes? That's one aspect that we need to obviously at some point also discuss, that finally people should start valuing the process and they should be able to do it and they should go for the process rather than it coming free to them. That's something that on the long-term basis, yes, we need to discuss that definitely. Because yeah. for the state, yes, definitely there are matters pending in courts and they want that backlog to finish, and they, of course, maybe that by itself, setting up courts and everything becomes an administrative issue. So they think, okay, this is one way of getting going about it. But on the long term, I still feel that people have to start valuing it and it should not really come for free to them. I don't know, your thoughts might be different to that. So that's, what would you say?
I understand. No, but here is very, it depends, because let me tell you one thing. I will do a comparison. In general, in our culture, in Chile, people love free things. I think it's something they have, love free things, why I must pay. But it, in some cases, believe it or not, because it's free, there is a lot of incentives to go to mediation, yeah? But what is the problem? The problem is because in the previous system, when you were paid for agreement, what is it? The one of the issues that become key, and the government it's very aware what happened, it's the schedule of mediation. In the system, if you are paid for agreement, what is your incentive to make a lot of mediation in the day? So, okay, let's start mediation. For example, mediator arrives to the office at 9 o'clock, and first mediation is 9:15, second mediation 10:15, third mediation 10:15, and eventually people arrive earlier, so you in one hall, in one room, is one mediation, and you're, okay, let's talk about it. I will be back in a few minutes, and the other mediation in the other room. It's really sick, yeah. And this, what happened, that is, the process is faster. In this scheme, where mediators are paid as employees, there is a slower pace. It's not so fast. So what is the problem? Some people say, oh, I am in a hurry. I need to regulate this issue because, for example, I must go to work abroad. Or, for example, I move to another city. And this generates that it's a market for private mediators who are not part of this public system. And therefore, the schedule is more free and you can make mediation faster. So it's like a If you want to, it's like I will make the same comparison. For example, if you go to the usual highway without any fee, that is slow, or you pay and you take the fast route, but it's expensive. That's it. That's the comparison.
So basically, you were now at that point when you got to know about the fellowship, you were basically a family mediator in the system. You were part of the family.
Yes, but also mediating not so much, but doing some mediation in healthcare law. But now I'm more engaged in, particularly not so much in family mediation, but mostly devoted nowadays in healthcare mediation. And that's another universe, very different.
You must tell us about that experience also, because look, thing is, in India, things are just about kind of happening, just about happening. Nothing much is happening, really, I would think. The courts, yes, in the courts, it's happening. But I definitely would like to not talk about that, because I think that the mediation has to develop on the private area. But there seems to be a signal problem, Patricio. So till the time Patricio comes back, let's just have a look at what is happening and what has happened in November in terms of events. Of course, sessions of the symposium are lying on the YouTube channel. Mediator Experiences, this series, lots of episodes. It's a new bill, which has been draft bill, which is circulating. Discussion on that. A bill which is, according to me, the worst thing that can happen. We have the best law on mediation, is what I keep saying. But this goes to a different tangent only. The lecture series. It's in Conversation of the Beautiful Mind. Lecture. Evolution of a Mediator. There's a new series on reflective practice. So Michael had some people from his Irish practice group coming in and taking us through what a meeting looks like. And Michael has now, I think, tasted blood. Now he's doing this first time this was the first time they were doing it, which was recorded and put out on YouTube. So now he's doing a lot of these. Book discount. Evolution of a Mediator. Rafael is the one who designed that poster. So he's the Santana of the Woodstock of Mediation. He's done it in Spanish also, his lecture. And Andrea, it's the last day of the month. Let me come back to the December thing after this.
Oh.
Yes, Patricio. You're back.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Maybe I have a problem.
No issue at all. This is normal. This is up till then. What I did was I was going through the slides of whatever I did in November. I would have wanted you to see also, but I'll take you through it.
Thank you.
Yeah. So you were saying that I was healthcare. I was saying, look, healthcare and all. India is really not. I mean, in terms of the private mediation outside the court system, nothing much has really happened. So I think the experiences from people all over the world in various areas. So your healthcare experience was also important. So you can tell us about that also.
Well, in Chile, it's interesting because here there's not public payment for mediation. So here is 100% paid. Yeah. And another difference is in family mediation, the people go without representation or without the help of lawyers. Here it's absolutely different, because in healthcare mediation, people usually go with lawyers, yeah? And there is also a regulation, you have a roster of healthcare mediations, you can apply and you eventually make incorporated in the roster of mediators. And the issue here is also a price that you fix for your services, but the price is not for session. The price is for process, yeah? So it's not as convenient. But what happened is, in general, this mediation is a lower level of agreement than family mediation. If you compare the level of agreement, it's considerably lower. But if you reach an agreement, there is for smaller amounts. So in concrete terms, healthcare mediation, which is in some degree what it resembles most or tend to be the possible scheme where civil mediation in Chile will be applied in future, because it's not yet, there is not a law for civil mediation. Usually this kind of mediation, it's like a small claim. It's for a small claim and regulates small issues, not the big ones. And maybe this happened particularly because of how the civil procedure is designed, what are the incentives of the civil procedure in order to gain time and make every trick that is possible to make this case long and arduous. And that's happened. So that's the thing, but it's different. And also the methodology, it changed, because there is an issue about empathy, of course. There is an issue about what is the expectation that you have. But here it started to be more technical, because you require more information. You require a lot about technical aspects, eventually things that can be considered like an exhibition of evidence previous to the case. This is something really important, because the lawyers generally and the organization involved in this process of healthcare mediation require information to determine if excessive any malpractice, and eventually if it's necessary to pay, and if the damage is correlated with the request made for the people in mediation. So it's far more technical.
Tell me, at the end of the day, after that healthcare mediation, the settlement agreement, what is the status of it in terms of enforceability? Is it just a contract, or does it have a...
No, it's absolutely enforceable. Yes, because the law established that if you agree, if you achieve an agreement with a mediator in healthcare law, is a transaction, and is it's equal to a final sentence of the last instance for all the issues. So it's completely applicable. Here is an issue, because some people say, okay, the mediator, it happens, not always, but sometimes happen that people make the agreement and it's signed at five the parties, five the mediator, and it's okay, you have your agreement of mediator. Because usually, here is an issue quite important, people want that this mediation become particularly secrecy, because it's engaged issue about healthcare, issues about your personal data related with health issues. And people don't want to be publicly disclosed. But other people say, okay, mediators regulate the agreement, but it's signed in a notary, because it's more, not more secure, but it gives you an additional certainty about the day what the agreement was signed, and that it takes another rules and another insurance and more guarantees that this nothing will change at the last moment. So, but it happens, but the agreement is negotiated and drafted by the mediator with the help of the parties.
Okay, so that means to enforce it, you have to get it notarized. That's what you're saying, as part of the law.
Yeah. Yeah, it's absolutely recognized because it says. But in Chile, the healthcare mediation, it's something that I may say, because you have two systems of healthcare mediation. A private healthcare mediation, which is, if you have a problem with a private hospital, you go to mediators who is in the roster of mediators of the health superintendents, where I'm registered, yeah? But if you have a problem with a public hospital, you must go to a mediation made in an administrative body called the Council of the Face of the State, which is an administrative agency that is in charge of the defense and the prosecution of cases in the name of the state. In that institution is vested the healthcare mediation. And it's quite different, because in this case, mediation is made for public servants, but is discussed eventually. But if you reach an agreement, the agreement is not signed automatically because it's necessary to go to the higher authorities of this council in order to accept the payment, and eventually it must go, for example, to Ministry of Finance that must approve the payment. So it goes outside of the rules of mediator.
But in terms of the person who from the government who actually settles it or agrees to a certain settlement, is there any issue that comes up later that the person settled something which they should not have, or they gave a higher amount than they should have? Do these issues come up? Because I always feel that the government and public servants might not want to stick their neck out, so that they might be questioned tomorrow whether this was a fair settlement or not. Does that issue come up?
No, generally, it's hard, the process to reach an agreement, yeah, but it's a lot of bureaucracy that to demonstrate that this payment must be done. And the analysis is technical and strategical, because the government says, okay, this is the time when we will consume in terms of go to this case. This is the possibility that we must pay, for example, for the lack of services, and the state must pay. So this is an opportunity, and it's a measure about the time required to reach an agreement and the time that required to finish the case. So they make analysis about time and money, and they, under these circumstances, eventually the government accepts. But once you have the last authorization of the public authorities in charge, for example, of the Council of Defense of the State and the Ministry of Finance, only when you achieve all the authorization, then the signature of the agreement is made. The agreement is achieved in substantial terms, but not formally is written, because once you achieve it and it's signed, the case is over.
Because I'm just thinking from the perspective of the person who initiates the amount, okay, this is the amount that should be paid. That person should never be questioned after that, because the thing is, in India, the government is the biggest litigant. So if in the government, if we can actually get it them to mediate all their matters, but or at the same time safeguarding the bureaucrat who actually sticks his neck out and says this should be the settlement, ideal situation if that can work out, because you can understand how huge the backlog here is.
Well, here we have a problem with backlogs, and there is in public healthcare mediation, the issue, and what is the key point that the government is very, very conscious and very aware, is that to avoid that any possible person related with the case can make any claim. So the process itself, it's quite focused about that all the possible people engaged in the case must be seated and brought to mediation. This is key point, because if you sign a mediation and one eventually children or one of the son of the people have not cited, eventually can not, it's not part of the agreement, and eventually can go to courts. And that's the issue. That's more important. So there's a correlation between the result that you want to obtain and the people who is engaged. So this is something that has an influence about how mediation is performed.
That's very good. I think you've put in place these things. I mean, in terms of getting there, all the work that has happened is amazing. But I still say, obviously, like the population is still, my city has more of a population than the entire country has.
Exactly. But I believe that, of course, the magnitudes are absolutely different. But here is an issue that the state, I believe, in my point of view, the state must establish a system where mediators will be paid and the parties will not. Something that happened in my country, because it's the kickoff of the industry, where it's established like an industry. There's an incentive that people want to work in this area. This is something important. It gives you a value to your job. It's important. It's well-ordinated. Sometimes it's a problem because, for example, tends to generate some kind of bias about how mediation must be. For example, in family mediation, as mentioned before, it's really important the narrative aspect and the psychological aspect, and all the theory particularly is influenced by Argentinian authors like Marina Suarez. But it's something in some degree determined by the bureaucrats who are in charge of the area, who design the test that you must take. So there's an influence about that. There is one of the problems. But in general, it's important. But above all, from my point of view, it's important that the government put money, started to pay the mediators, give the possibility that people go to mediation, and also use technology. Because technology is a big friend in my point of view. In the case of India, for example, you are a powerhouse about software industry and eventually in technology of mobile phones. So I think there is a big space in this area in a highly populated country like in India. Why? Because, for example, one of the things that happened here in Chile is this contract required you to, in family mediation, the contract says that for make mediation must be presentially, and you may have a room, and this room must have a measure of maybe 3 meters, at least 9 square meters, the room of mediators, and must exist a table, and this table must be rounded. Cannot make mediation. Yeah, really. They say the table must be rounded. And why this happened? Because theoretically, author says that the round table is something that creates a sense of equality because no person is in charge of this.
And this comes from the traditional system, the circles that they have in the indigenous communities. It all comes from that. And that's a perfectly all right. That's a good thing. I'm even saying, why do you have to do it in a room? You should do it outside under a tree also. Anywhere. Mediation can happen anywhere.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah, that's it. For example, in JAMS, something that opened my mind was in JAMS when I was doing the fellowship, the mediation were made in a huge corporate board's table, not square. There was something huge, and nobody cares about what in some rooms more smaller there is around the table, but nobody was worried about how was the table and what is the shape of the table. There are far more important problems to solve and to be worried about. So that demonstrates one of the problems when people or bureaucracy take control of this aspect. It's a good thing, but it's a bad thing for other aspects.
Well, I think what is happening in India now is, like I was telling you about this draft mediation bill, which is circulating. Basically, the government wants to get into mediation in some way or the other. Right now, we have a very good law where everything is flexible. Parties do what they want to. And at the end of the day, you get a settlement agreement, which is as good as a court decree. Damn good. Everything is nice. And here, they want to actually get into a mediation council of India, put bureaucrats in that council. So, I mean, taking it into a level which I feel where we are zero. Maybe actually, private mediation is zero. Court-related mediation, I have a totally different view. I keep saying that they have no business to be touching mediation also, because the whole concept of going to a court is different, and going for mediation is a different, totally different area of practice of dispute resolution, which should not get merged together. Because I keep talking about this whole colonization aspect and the colonizer's mindset to put dispute resolution only in the courts, and that whole brainwashing that has happened of people over hundreds of years, that is where you will resolve your disputes. You can't do it within yourselves. So traditional methods of dispute resolution were destroyed. So all that thing, I'm trying to get all that discussion happening on those issues. That's why the symposium was basically about that only, to get that discussion going. But you have a different view of that. Yeah, you have a different view on that. Yeah.
Well, I think that, yes, but litigation is not necessarily so bad as you believe. Yeah, it's necessary because litigation must exist. And there is an aspect that litigation, for example, here in Chile, we have a big problem with health, with private health care. And most of the changes in the abusive clause of health care programs were made throughout massive litigation in our courts. Change it, but this litigation was not civil litigation. It was a litigation made throughout constitutional actions that changed the plans. Yeah, it's huge amount of money, a huge amount of costs for our population in entering into the courts. Now have become very, very automatized, very, very simplified, and it was helpful because litigation, in some degree, allowed to regulate issues or social issues. Yeah. Without to go, for example, to the parliament. So it's litigation as a regulation. This is something that happened and must be recognized. But the problem, and here is in the design of the procedural law. Because, for example, if you have a system that allow you to make a lot of incidents or use a lot of tricks and generate a lot of incidents or present a lot of motions in order to make slower the procedure, it's clear that litigation become, irregular, yeah? It's something that it's become sick. It's a litigation that is not helpful to solve the problems, and that must be changed. But if you incorporate into the litigation, into the procedure, for example, punishment for the parties that use bad faith in your litigation, or for example, if you limitate the possibility to present motions, and if you started to incorporate this, or eventually, if you establish, okay, if you, why you don't go to mediation or try to solve or try to settle or try to get to an agreement, if you incorporate into the civil procedure this kind of technical devices, it's more possible that you may opt to negotiate, to reach an agreement. So there is the correlation between litigation and mediation and ADR in general. At the basis, I think that one of the problems is about the training and the education of the lawyers, how the lawyers are educated. And this is a big problem in my point of view.
Look, Patricio, I have no problem with litigation existing. Not a problem. Like you said, if I'm even saying that if people want to litigate, they whatever facilities they need to litigate, do let them do that. Not a problem. That's their choice. But if they have gone for litigation, let them litigate. Why do you want to, as a judiciary, want to get into mediation in any manner at all? My issue is with that, that you have nothing to do with it. It's a totally diametrically opposite method of dispute resolution. The person has come to you for a reason. If you are not efficient, you make yourself efficient. Why, if people are being forced to go for mediation because you are inefficient, that is the problem. People should want to go for mediation because they want to mediate. And that is where the whole culture of mediation has to be developed. I am saying that you become so efficient and mediators should be out of business. No one should want to go to mediation because there is no choice. They should not go there only because, okay, we can't litigate because it's too long, it's too expensive. Okay, what is another method? Maybe let's mediate. No, let them go for mediation if they want to go for mediation, go for litigation if they want to go for litigation. That choice should be available to them. Don't push them. Don't make a circuit. Because I'm telling you why I keep saying that, Patricio. I'll tell you why. Because the basic foundation behind this is that the fact that you are wanting to clear your backlog. So you will create mandatory mediation, costs on mediation, force you into mediation, for opt in, opt out, or everything you keep doing. While you should be putting your house in order, if the procedural law is coming in the way, do something about the procedural law. Go into those aspects of things. Let's just leave mediators and mediation alone, because in our country, let me tell you, our country and most other countries, what has happened is that litigation takes so long that obviously it is, criminal. It's a criminal act, according to me, to put someone through 20 years of litigation because you are inefficient. Arbitration has gone the same way. People have challenged arbitral awards in the courts. They have been pending for 20 years. So you as a court system has finished off arbitration also. Now, what else is left? Mediation. Let's get into that. You are inefficient. You understand that you can't do your job properly. Just concentrate on that. Do your job better and let this evolve the way it has to evolve. Those are my radical views on this. Yeah, Patricia, sorry, please.
No, really interesting because okay, I recognize that you have a strong point about your arguments, yes. But I think that maybe one of the key points is the role of the lawyers. I think the role of the lawyers absolutely. Usually tend to, they do not make a value about mediation. And it is something that I believe, and something that I learned in the fellowship, it's that the American culture, it's a practical culture. They're absolutely practical persons. So one of the things that I remember that I hear in a conversation that I have in San Francisco, it's shorter. Mediation, it's valuable because the lawyers has a concept about how the people has the freedom to decide. And the people also, it's a possibility that people eventually not necessarily go to the court because mediation, it's more convenient. It's more predictable, and something that I believe is something that required that you as a person take control of your own decisions. It's an issue about your maturity, If you are a mature person that is able to take decision important, it's far more easy to that the judge or your lawyer say, you must take this decision, say what to say, what to do, yeah? But mediation is something that you act like an adult person, like a rational person that take decisions, good decisions, bad decisions, but take it and accept the consequences of that. And I think that is one of the risks. So it's something that's more related with the culture in terms of that people become aware that they are the owners of their own destiny. And to take decisions is important. So it's something, I repeat, democracy is not to go to vote to 5 years or 3 years. Democracy is to do what you want to do and accept it and take the benefits and the cost thereof. And I think that mediation must be in some degree an exercise about that. So there is an issue about education and there is an issue about lawyers, because I'm a lawyer, of course, but some colleagues really are thinking about the legal fees or thinking about the potential and how is the amount that you receive as an average, as a percentage of the indemnization that are requested. And is here in that point, there is a perverse incentive that happened in mediation also, but it's a perverse incentive. So I believe, like you said, okay, people must freely elect if they want to go to mediation, but you must be very aware and attack this perverse incentive that happens.
Well, I think what you said about the role of lawyers, first of all, according to me, it was supposed to be a noble profession, and you were supposed to advise parties in the best of their interest, definitely. But because I don't blame lawyers if things changed, because as a society we changed. Materialism became an important aspect of the way society was structured. A lawyer is not separate from society. He's part of society. If that society is going to be materialistic, then lawyer is part of it. So for the lawyer to start thinking about himself or herself or whatever gender is thinking about themselves, there's nothing, I can't say they're wrong. They're also part of the structure of society. So I don't blame them. But the thing is that there will be some people like you, me, we are lawyers, but we do not think that way. We think that what is the best that we can do for the parties, and if they can settle, create a certain atmosphere for them to settle. Day one from my practice, even if in an arbitration, I went, I said, settle. I have reached out to the other side. The other side has had that much trust in me that they have said, okay, why don't you mediate? And they have their own lawyer, they've set aside or put aside and said, why don't you do it? So, I mean, you have to create that atmosphere, but how do you create that atmosphere when a society is looking at the materialistic aspect of it? The lawyer has to, whatever, if he has to buy that new car for himself, he wants to buy that new car for himself. How do you tell that lawyer, no, you rise above everything else? You are going to be a different human being. You are at a different level altogether. Yeah. How do you tell that lawyer that? I can't tell that lawyer that. If he's part of society, he's part of society.
Yeah, it's a very shrewd point that you mentioned, because yes, in general, lawyers, I'm a lawyer like you, yeah, but sometimes there is a typical lawyer. And yes, in some degree, lawyers tend to have a flamboyant and sometimes stylish lifestyle that it's based in your fees and you must show off a lifestyle to be considered a properly or successful lawyer. Yes, but there is an issue about the general regulations, because yes, the people is free. The lawyers tend to promise that they can solve almost everything. And some people tend to be selfish about more thinking about their own interest in the case than, or to generate a prestige about their role as a litigator or strong litigators. But I believe, and this we're in times of change, and these times of change, well, all the times of change, but in these times, I think that it's there are some important issues to solve, because the access to justice, it must be considered something remarkable, and it's part of the freedom of the people, because you cannot create a society who live in peace with people litigating absolutely or bringing all the things to the court to solve problems. In my point of view, there is a lot of people that is going to court to make something that close or resemble like psychological theory. It's there's something that going to go to court to make a cathartic process, as and that thing that that doesn't happen in a court. This thing may happen eventually in mediation, but this thing might happen in, for example, in a context of the social and psychological progress of the society. But this is an issue. So there are mixed many aspects that must be analyzed, separated, and must be, I think, regulated, but generate the possibility of the freedom of a people, as you mentioned, to select freely. Yeah. And it's something that is part of our democracy. It's a real democracy.
Interesting. Look, I'm coming back to this aspect, what I was talking about, the lawyer being part of society and the materialistic society that we have developed. When you said the flamboyant aspect of lawyers and everything, they have to do it because, like you said, the society recognizes people who have a certain something. They recognize that. They want to go to those people. So their own costs, they increase their own costs because you are funding the lawyer's flamboyant lifestyle because you want to believe that the success comes from that. It's a vicious circle. So they should get what they're getting. If they're getting more expensive litigation, they should get it because that's the way they have created that system. So I am saying that that part of it, I don't even want to touch because they've done it to themselves. Society has done it to themselves, however they have done it. So I'm not going to blame the lawyers. I'm not going to blame anyone. This is just the way we are. I mean, we have to start relooking life from on a different angle altogether. Yeah, you're saying something.
Well, but in Chile, something happened similar because there is, in the general public or as a general idea, it's looked like a lawyers is a prestigious profession with eventually you can achieve again a lot of money. But in reality, we have one of the highest rate of a lawyer per capita in the world. And it's something that is affected because a lawyer is not a profession that assured you that you will have a glamorous lifestyle. It doesn't happen. Yeah. Yeah, we're an impoverishment about the legal community, a difference of the medical, because the medical are very united. There are only one body. It doesn't matter what happened, but they fight all together for the same objectives, with the protection of their own protection. Lawyers here in Chile are more independent. And this process of impoverishment of the profession demonstrate that there's a lot of people eager to make money. Not necessarily to have a flamboyant lifestyle, because they need to pay their bills monthly and to pay their basic needs. So it's an issue there to consider. But it's no matter what happened, I agree with you in the terms that it's necessary to consider the role of the lawyers in the promotion or the less incentive that they have to give people to accept these opportunities and to express freely. It's something that
because I'm going to come to this because I'm telling you the aspect of the if you have to show people that mediation as a profession and how you can actually practice it where you can get enough work for yourself. This being a full-time mediator is not happening anywhere in the world. I was speaking to a senior mediator today and we were talking about this for the future also. He said, I don't see people being able to practice as full-time mediators. There's not going to be enough work for them. And he's a senior mediator and I mean, internationally known. And he says, it's not going to happen. If I cannot show that to a mediator on that end. And of course, we have lawyers on the other end who definitely, look, first of all, they're all category. I mean, lawyer is, of course, one word that we use. But in, say, a country like India, a lawyer might be charging $10 for a hearing. There's a lawyer who charges $30,000 for a hearing. So it's so wide a range. So to even say that we can have something which is true for each one of them, their needs are different, their circumstances are different. So definitely we won't be able to generalize on that. But to tell them that, look, this should be an option that you should take your parties through. How will the person see a future in that practice if they do not see enough work coming into that practice? So I'm saying that there is some kind of a fundamental issue somewhere all over the world. It's not, I don't know, Chile or anywhere. Everywhere is the same problem, that the work hasn't been created or hasn't happened the way we would think. So either we are not required and we have come into the picture only because the courts are inefficient. So we should just tell ourselves, are we not serving a purpose in society? Why aren't people going for mediation? Why in the US? I keep talking about it, and you'll hear this if you watch all my other shows also. Yeah. You'll get bored of it. You'll get irritated. Why does this guy keep saying the same thing? But when I look at the US situation and I see that there are 100 million cases filed in courts every year, and an institution like JAMS does only 18,000 matters in the whole year. And that's supposed to be the largest institution in the world for ADR. There is a mismatch somewhere. 100 million there, 18,000 here. So where is the issue there? Why I dug a little deeper into this. So I saw the court system. And of course, helped by Jeff Kitchavin, who's a senior mediator, in his session of the symposium, he was talking about it, that how in the court system, these people come in to practice as mediators. They come in with this, yes, we will practice here. We will, of course, give our time almost for free, whatever nominal price, but the lawyers will, because it's a lawyer-driven mediation process there. So lawyers will recognize us, and then they will take us for private matters. But that doesn't happen. So this whole lot gets disillusioned, moves away. A new lot comes in. Again, the same thing. They're used almost for free, but nothing, private work doesn't come to them. They get disillusioned. So in that sense, at the end of 40, 45 years of mediation being in that country, people are not looking at that as a first option. So there's some fundamental issues there. Then we have to discuss that, Patricia. We have to get down to the bottom of that. But you were saying something. Again, I cut you. Yeah.
I think that about the possibility that any person eventually become a full-time mediator, in my experience, or I think that happened here in my country, here in Chile, you become in some degree, for a time, if you have a contract, full-time mediator, eventually. Yes, but it's something very curious, because sometimes mediators that start as mediators then become entrepreneurs and become owners of center of mediators. Yeah. So it's not so bad at all.
Patricio, is bad. I'll tell you what is happening. The only money that is being made in mediation is by training. That's all that's happening. That's where the money has been made. There's Andrew Miller, he's from the UK, and a very senior mediator there, very well-recognized mediator. In his session of the symposium, he says 18,000 qualified, certified mediators are there. Only 500 have work. So that means you actually trained these other 17,500, took huge amounts from them. You know, it's not cheap in the UK, that qualification, everything, not cheap. You took money from them. They paid huge, but that's a big industry you created. But at the end of the day, how does it matter whether you created a big industry and institutions and everything? Did that mediator get work at the end of the day? That did not happen. And that's not happening. So that aspect for that entrepreneur creating that institution, that's the route everyone has taken. For me, I'm telling you, I'm clear on this, that I will not go the institution route. That's the most easy thing to do. Let's have training issues. Let's certify. Let's put them out. I said, no, I will not go that route. I did. You know, on my website, I said, support me. I said, send me a gift, because I do not want to look at that as an option. Everyone goes that route. And we have to be able to understand that, where has it led people? We've got lots of qualified people, in the sense certified by various institutions. But we have to find out how many of them can actually work as only mediators. It is a part-time thing for them. Okay, I'm certified. I'm a lawyer or whatever other profession. And I'm also a certified mediator. If you have something, okay, I'll do that. But that doesn't create a profession. The profession gets created when you have full-time people working in that profession. Like you said, okay, in your case, you were saying lawyers do not get together. In our country, of course, lawyers get together. They have a proper this thing, unions, and we're not called the unions, but associations. But mediators, nothing at all. There are associations for mediators, but they're all mediators in the court system. What about private mediators? Private mediation, not represented, because they aren't enough. I'm one of the rare full-time mediators. They aren't there. So how do we get together? How do we fight for a cause? So that profession, we need to finally look. Finally, the profession has to develop. And the profession develops not by you saying that, yes, they're only by training and qualification. Profession develops and people, they have a need for it. If people don't even think there is a need for it, what is that use of that profession? So finally, it comes down to the people and whether they find value in mediation. That's the way I look at it.
Yeah, it's a strong point, but I believe that there's a long-term objective to achieve. I agree with you, but it's a long-term objective that becomes a professional, recognized, full-time, well-paid. But we must be realistic. And realistically, we must accept that, yes, there is public money engaged in this issue, and there's private people. And if the private people want to pay. During the pandemic, occurred something, I don't say if miraculous or eventually practical, what is mediation cannot be performed throughout, at least in the for the public, for the centers who are paid with public money. The government does not allow to make mediation online, yeah? And must be done, use it presentially. And in some moment, okay, cannot be done because the higher rate of contagion of the pandemic was extremely risky. And then open the door that private mediation become to be important in our society. And also it was important because private mediators, they were allowed with some courts to do mediation using online system. So that's something, this was a disruptive event. Yeah, pandemic changed many things, and that allowed, for example, to open the possibility that private mediators to become insert in this area. Of course, it's something that would not last eventually, but open the door to a change. Yeah, something that before it was impossible to do. So it's something that may happen. Yeah, it's as I mentioned before. I believe that things are not easy. All the process to consolidate, for example, ADR, to consolidate mediation, or consolidate in general this new system takes a time at least between 5 and 10 years. Yeah? Is this my point?
Patricio, we're talking about the US 40, 45 years. Today also, if you ask them how many are full-time mediators, you will see, find out the answer, you will get the answer yourself. It's not a matter of years. It's a matter of the way it has been approached. And it is because, look, a self-interest of the court system is not going to create a profession. It's going to even only destroy the profession. It can't, how will it benefit if you are going to say that it's almost for free and you have a facility available? There was one senior mediator in India who was speaking about this, that he set up a mediation with some of his colleagues, lawyers, set up a mediation center and doing well. And the court started a mediation center there. They closed down the mediation center, the private one. So it's a problem. Yeah.
Yes, because there's another aspect here in Chile, the last years as it's happening or growing a new trend, because they think that mediation, they see like this movement idea, in particular in academia, there is a trend that believes that this moment, this trend of ADR and this is like an extreme version of the neoliberalism and an extreme privatization of the justice, and they don't like it, yeah? This happened. There's a lot of people that think it's something unacceptable. And also there is an important theoretical, but not theoretical, just not merely theoretical aspect to be considered, which is, for example, that it in the access to justice may have a limit, because one of the formulas that must be assured in any constitution or in any legal system is to have an effective coverage of the justice. Yeah, of the judicial branch. So it's something, these two problems or these two perspectives fight one against other, or at least not absolutely sustainable at the same time. So this is a problem that we must accept. And of course, how this mediation as a profession to be created is in many aspects dependent of the political and sociological aspect that we cannot control absolutely, but we may have an influence.
Well, but I'm saying, Patricio, it's still a mindset issue. The fact that you said about some people, about the access to justice and all that, I still feel that there is a colonial aspect of it, that the courts being set up by the colonizer and you have to go there. I'm saying that you have a dispute between a party, both of you have a contract, so-and-so has to pay so-and-so. Why does the state have to get involved in it? It's between you people. You want to, that's why the whole concept of arbitration is available. You want to fight it out, you fight it out. And the state to come into these private disputes on these issues, should they come in at all? Okay, they create a system for you where the option is given for you to get there, but it can take 20 years if some people don't have money. How do we take care of that? How can the state fund those? But the point is, at the end of the day, it's a dispute that you've got into. You are in fighting within yourselves. Why should the state be funding your disputes of this kind? You have to pay, that person is not paying. What? It's between both of you. Why is the state interfering in you funding that dispute of yours?
Well, I believe that in one of my experience before the scholarship of JAMS, I have the opportunity to be JICA scholarship in 2004. And I was making an internship in Japan during 4 months. And one of the most amazing things that I realized in Japan, it's, for example, about they are absolutely, they're not interested about to go to court. And they have just a few lawyers because it's very difficult to become a lawyer in Japan. And the problem that they have is just a few lawyers. They need more lawyers. It's something absolutely completely different. But one of the things that it was really interest me, it was how the contracts are drafted in Japan. And this is, they are drafted in very general terms, yeah? And also there is, as you mentioned, a mindset where to go to court is something that is not acceptable because in general terms, the Japanese society tends to prioritize the social order, the harmony, and they are strongly linked with the honor. So if you go to court eventually, there is something that you put your honor in risk. So that's the reason that many of the cases are settled without go to court. In this case, I believe that they must be an example about the things that you're talking about. But of course, it's something that is very specific of one country, and it's highly related with their mindset. Yeah, so I think it is interesting, and it's not replicable. You can take some things that eventually may be useful to replicate because we cannot copy absolutely because there are cultural factors, historical factors, and eventually social and legal matters that cannot be replicated absolutely. But you can achieve an inspiration from these cases.
No, but you'd be very surprised, Patricio, that in a country like ours, you might think we have a large backlog and 18 million cases go into courts. We have a population of 1.3 billion people, 18 million go into courts. But no, there has been a report on this saying that only 5% of the matters go into courts, which means actually there are 400 disputes out there, which do not go to the total two disputes might be 400, which matches the US situation. That means one in terms of population, there are 300 million population, they have 100 million matters going to courts. If this report is correct, that means India has 400 cases out there. And with a population of 1.3 billion, translates into the same. So which means we are doing something right, which means this honor and other aspects are today also important in that society. So we have to be able to take it from there and rather not go into a situation where the courts become the only option. So 400 matters go into court. And then after that, what happens with them? How the courts, the lawyers take control of it and other ADR processes? We can't afford to do it because we can't handle 18 million going into courts. 400 million will destroy everything. So I think we are somewhere, we have something right. We must be able to tap into that, find out what's happening out there. People are actually settling their disputes otherwise. It is not that they are relying only on courts in even a society like ours. Yeah, you were saying something.
But it's interesting the situation because usually we're very, very, we tend to be some countries and not all. Yeah, that you mentioned about it happening in India, it's surprising because, but I believe this maybe have to, there is a correlation eventually about some cultural and even religious aspect that tends to be, in my point of view, from in a very, 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 not exactly precise, because the people is about how is their eagerness about to how they evaluate and valorate the peace, to live in peace, to not become engaged in disputes. So something that you mentioned in India, it's related how do people evaluate this peace, the peace as a culture, as something and it's necessary to live your life in a more simple manner. It's something that maybe in Western is not happening. And here in Chile, of course, we want to live in peace, but the valuation about the conflict, it's different because in some aspect, people in this time think that conflict is something that is associated with the progress because it generates, it pushes the boundaries. Yeah, it moves the boundaries and you need you not necessarily can do something by peaceful manner, or eventually you need to fight to achieve an objective. So maybe it's interesting that you mentioned, because numbers, which is reality, indicates that in India, people, it's more practical. And, yeah. And there is distrusting, and I think that people are distrusting in their, maybe in their colleagues, in the elders, or in religious person. It doesn't matter, but there is something about trust. And trust, and trust about the peace. So I think that is an issue there that it's interesting that you mentioned. I think that it was different. So it was surprising.
Yeah, because I think we, of course, need to dig deeper into, again, I like to say this, keep dig a little deeper, because sometimes what happens is what we read in terms of statistics, because of the fact that it is largely rural. Of course, at least 60% is a rural population in India. So the traditional methods, are they working? Like you said, respect for elders and elders coming, is that working? Yeah. Or is it that these people do not have access to courts? It's so expensive, so they stay away from it. So all those aspects also could be playing a role. And are there people who just are forced into certain things? There are all kinds of social structures that are might be there. But at the end of the day, all I look at is that if we can in some way strengthen traditional methods. Well, and please.
No, it's interesting because one of the experiences that I saw personally, it was in Spain. I don't know if you are hearing about it. It's something called Tribunal de las Aguas. What it means is the Court of the Waters. It's something that happened in Valencia. Each Tuesday, there is an old man that go to the door of the Cathedral of Valencia, and the people say, oh, we have a problem with the water, with the water allocation. Yeah, and they say, okay, talk to you. No, my problem is blah, blah, blah. Okay. Okay, what do you say? No, blah, blah, blah. Okay, the solution is this. Okay, the people sign. And even they sign an agree something, but it's achieved. And this is an immaterial heritage of the culture of Valencia. And this is interesting because it's a demonstration, something that you said, in terms that there are traditional manners to solve problems that people eventually may accept. But there is something that must be understood, and the state must recognize, and the society must recognize. And it's interesting. I'm not sure, but it happens, as you say, in the rural aspect, in the countryside, people tend to be more practical because their lives are harsh, are difficult, and they don't need additional problems. Something that happened also for the big business in the corporation in the big cities, but it's different, but it's similar in the depth.
But you know, interesting thing that you came up, because the traditional methods and the state should recognize it. In the symposium, there was someone from Kenya, James Mangerere. He spoke about what the situation in Kenya is. So they have, of course, the traditional method happening. So they have the chiefs and they have all that structure there. So there was a murder which took place in a community. So the community within themselves came up with a solution. That the victim's family would be given 15 camels. Okay, community finished, matter finished for them. But the police took up the matter because it's a crime. So we must file a complaint. Okay, complaint was for, maybe they did not even a complaint, no complainant came. They just registered a case. Matter went to court. No one came to court. No complainant, no witness, nothing. So the judge, of course, understanding the system, sent the police to the community, asked them what was the solution. They said this was a solution. He passed an order on that basis. He accepted that. It was majorly criticized. But how can you do this? The penal code says this is the punishment for murder. He said our constitution recognizes our traditional methods. So today the law in that country is that traditional method is recognized. Countries are not looking at that. First of all, the traditional method was destroyed by the colonizer. They did not want people to do that. They wanted the courts. They created that. So that's why I'm saying that decolonization is the first thing that we'll have to start looking at, because certain places, I was in the symposium, there was someone from Brazil. I was asking them about the traditional method. They said, we have no idea. Before the Portuguese came, what was the situation? We have no idea about dispute resolution in that country. So can you imagine how a full traditional method of dispute resolution has been destroyed? So to get that back, and society has changed. The structure of society has changed. People have moved, say urbanization has created a whole thing where people are not in communities the way they should be. Valencia might be a small community. So definitely might be easier. But in a city like, well, whatever, I mean, you say your capital, they might be, they might not be the communities the way they are. So how do you get that whole flow of them getting together and resolving things happening? So a lot of things have to happen on that. We are not, I think, not even considering those aspects. Here, the only focus is, can we make it mandatory? Can we put costs on parties if they don't go for mediation? Do they, if they refuse in an unreasonable manner? I mean, what are we concentrating on? We have to focus on something which is a long-term foundation that you have to create for dispute resolution. But we are focusing on something because the immediate thing. Right now, what is the situation? Courts are overloaded. Let's get the matters out. Whatever. I mean, this is the way I'm looking at it, but definitely these things need to be discussed. I'm not saying what I'm saying is has to be what has to be.
I think it's reasonable, because one of the important things that we must consider is about, yes, as you mentioned, for example, we have an indigenous population, and they have some tradition about how to regulate conflicts. We have a tradition. Our country now is living a process of change our constitution. We have a constitutional convention which is in charge to draft a new constitution after a very, very moved and turmoil in 2019. But nowadays, one of the issues eventually may have to recognize how the indigenous people solve these conflicts. Yeah, we have historically in our country, one of the traditions that helped it was the parliament. And the parliaments were situation or instance where indigenous people negotiated with the Spanish crown. Yeah, it's something that it happens in the past, and eventually this kind of methods may arise or may surge again. It's something that may happen. It's something absolutely under discussion. But I agree with you that we must try to search and to get inspiration from these traditional methods. Maybe it's not can be applicable in the same manner, because our society, as you mentioned, is changing, but we can take an inspiration and adapt it to our reality nowadays, giving more space to the people that solve the problem by themselves without the intervention of the state. Is something extremely, in this case, is important. But one of the problems is politicians and people who has eager to power and to access to the huge amount of resources that the state manage. So it's something that happens.
But Patricio, you have to, again, I keep going back to this. This is entire the colonization aspect of it, that divide and rule. A politician does not want people to get together and resolve the disputes. If they start collaborating with each other, they won't be able to divide them. If they can't divide them, how will they show that they are important? So it's a very complex structure where you can't pick up one thing and say, okay, this has to happen. So there are a lot of factors, but interesting thing, let me tell you, you picked up Valencia. Let me show you this one person from Valencia into police mediation, Antonio Berlanga. They've actually done a good work in that, in police mediation. It's actually, they developed an app, which I have not been able to access because the app store here doesn't show that app. But they're doing interesting work. So Valencia example, I was just thinking, I just saw this, that yes, there is activity happening in Valencia. We have to find out how come. There's something good they're doing. So we must learn from them.
Yes, of course. Yes, because it's quite traditional. It's absolutely amazing because it's the court of the waters. And it's interesting because it's this is an inheritance of the Arabic influence in the management of waters, something that it's a problem worldwide. Maybe in India, it's something that it happens because one of the key points is the natural resource. In some degree, it's happening here in Chile. And for example, one of the interests nowadays is to understand what happens with to solve social conflicts associated with the big, with the great scale projects that affects nature. And in this area, most of the claims are made by communities. So how you give communities the possibility to have an influence. As I mentioned before, yes, litigation, it's usually one of the main case or the only case to try to go to stop this project or change this project. But in Chile, it happens that throughout conciliations in the courts, they create structures or agreements that recognize the possibility that direct negotiation in future of this project between between enterprise communities and generating and the space of dialogue. So this is something that is something it's very in the initial stages of some experimental cases. It's not widely spread, but this is it's a growing trend that we, at least in my point of view, we must follow. Because if this happens, it's demonstrate or given space of direct negotiation between the parties without intervention of space, generating and space for the dialogue and public participation. They are not the same. Public participation, it's not necessarily conflict solving, but helps a lot to achieve this objective in the medium and long term.
But tell Patricio, Peru has done a lot of work on it. I think that is a model for this work. There was this person called Luis Ore in Peru.
Yeah.
He was on my show that In Conversation with the Beautiful Mind. If you go to my YouTube or my website, mediatorvikram.com, you can find this link to his session. He took us through what is happening. On next Thursday, coming Thursday, not this Thursday, the one after that, Ivan from Peru is coming. He's done excellent work on this aspect where communities are affected by projects. So they've done very interesting work. And I think that's a model for the world. People have to look at the way what the work they've done.
Yes, they're extremely, they're more advanced than us.
You have to see the work. Ivan sent me videos of their various projects that they have done. And I mean, communities are so happy. First time there is actually a dialogue happening and they feel a part of the process, the part of the solution. It's really remarkable that one country can do so much work on that and other countries have not even maybe looked at it. So I think we need to,
Yes, for example, we are in Chile, we're interested in trying to replicate something that Peru is doing. Ivan is one of the fellows of the year that I study in the JAMS scholarship. And yes, he's making an outstanding work and to engage communities in great scale projects, of course. But it's interesting that this is a manner or how to take in consideration the value, for example, of the traditional knowledge, the traditional communities, and how to insert in the medium, long term in a direct dialogue without the incorporation of the states. Is something that it must be taken account. If I suggest if there is any one of the members of the fellows that is from Australia or Canada, they can give you even a wider experience because they are very advanced in this issue, or New Zealand.
Sarah Blake from Australia was part of the symposium. You can watch her session. She has spoken about the work they've done there. So she's done work with the indigenous communities there. So you'll have to, you know how to find this. You know how to find it. Let me just show you how to find on my website. I will have to just take you through that. So on the website, there is a section called very simple. It's called Symposium Number One. So let me. Have you seen that? Have you seen that? I don't know.
Perfect. Yeah.
So you just have to go here. This is the this is the section which is the. There are too many sessions. Look at the number of sessions there are.
There's a lot of job.
96 speakers, one closing address by Dr. Professor Sukhsimranjit Singh. Okay.
It's remarkable how many jobs are you doing.
Okay, this is Symposium Number One section. So this, we just search for Sarah Blake. And this is what you find, speaker number 26.
Yeah.
So you must watch her session also. But interesting thing on on traditional methods, there are some interesting sessions we had. One was, of course, James Mangirere, that you must watch. James, this one, 72.
Perfect.
Then you must watch the work that Christian Cherenji has done in Romania. What is this? One sec. He's from Romania, but he went to Crete in Greece and he studied the traditional system there. So he's done work there. Then we have from Israel, we have David Shimoni. He's speaking about number 62. He's speaking about how traditional mediators obviously had the trust of the community. So they had an important role to play. But of course, a lot of times they were telling people what to do. So was it true mediation or not? So he's saying, why don't we have co-mediation? A hybrid model, a model where the modern Okay, modern is, of course, to be defined. Modern mediator and the traditional mediator come together and co-mediate. And then the negatives of the traditional, but the positives stay. So something like that. So, I mean, there has been interesting things which have come out from the symposium also, which we need to start looking at in various countries. So a lot of work there. Yeah.
Yes, yes. It's absolutely amazing because there's not, I would not say that this is a crisis about the state, but it's important to open your mind to new systems that there is not so new at all. There is some, it's not so new at all. There is just an adaptation about traditional models. Yes, and it's important. But I think I agree with you, it's an issue about, because as I mentioned before, I think that democracy is not something that related only to make, to give your vote each 4 years or 3 years. It's something that you live in your daily life.
Patricio, you picked up a very, you've used the word democracy, which is a big issue, because I'll tell you what I've been discussing and I've been talking about it. In a country like India or the US, if you, all you have to do is just look at the election.
Yes.
The Joe Biden in the US has 33% of the votes. That's it. Out of the 100% of the votes of the country, he has only 33%. How a minority rules a country, I'm using the word rule for the moment, it's still not ruling, they lead the government, let's just say, 33% do that. Now, if you are going to be 33% ruling over the other, so you're a minority ruling over the majority, definitely it is not a democracy, according to me. So your whole method of going about it will be the colonizer's method. Because only a colonizer had a minority ruling the majority. In India, you'll be surprised, the current government has only 25% of the votes of the entire country because people don't go and vote. In the US, 37% of the people did not vote. In India, it's above almost 40% did not vote. How do you create a democracy without people voting? So we have to start looking at that also. If we have to create democracies today, it's a nice thing to use. Okay, people have the right to vote, so we are a democracy. No, democracy happens when people vote and you are a majority government. Then you become a democracy. Even in a company, you will not have a situation like this that the minority shareholders will be running it. Has to be a board. The board will have to be a majority. You can't say a minority will decide. In companies, we don't let that happen. For a country, we let that happen. It's a lot of, you picked up a wrong thing, Patricio. You've taken me to another area which I'm really passionate about.
It's true, because democracy, it's not the mere fact that you go to vote. Democracy is something that you live every day of your life, yet you take decisions. This is something important. We have, for example, here in South America, particularly in Chile, we have a love affair with Scandinavian countries. We think that this is a model we want to follow because they're small, they're rich, they're ecological, they're feminist, and they're very advanced and an exceptional welfare state. But in concrete terms, what makes this country at last? Is there democracy? Is a democracy where the people all the days take decision when they say, I'm made responsible of that. It's something that goes beyond election. It's go beyond the mere vote. And that's something that I'm thinking about. And this culture of mediation, it's about peace. Yes, of course, because people want to live in peace, and peace is necessary to prosper and to live a life in dignity and tranquility. But I think it's more important that we understand that democracy is not to obey a leader. It's something that you are able to obey and to take your own decision in the best interest and negotiate with other person. It's something so simple like that, but it's hard. It's really hard.
Very interesting point you brought out, because if in that democracy, people know that they have a voice and they're part of the conversation, by itself, that culture of mediation comes in. That's where it starts from. But if you have created this, again, I'll keep using this thing about colonizing, but you've created this colonizer structure where the government is here, people are here, there is no interaction, there is no dialogue happening. So obviously, where will the culture of mediation come in? They're not used to it. So I think that work has to happen on that. What you're saying is very true, that we need to start looking at democracy, first of all, from a different perspective. Are we really a democracy? Yeah.
Nowadays in my country, we are living this process after a very hard situation that we live in 2019 with many riots and turmoil that was really complicated for us. and then come pandemic in 2020. And now we're living this process of the Constitutional Convention. And one of the issues is about, yes, that people, it's, as you mentioned, the state is here and the population is here, but what's something in the middle? People want to express, yes, people want to take their own decision, but is this a space really fill it in a manner that people may feel comfortable and that people it's participating? This is the question you must task and we must address, because politics, it's become one of my opinions, in some degree politics has become a manner to solve problems in that replace the direct negotiation of the party in a more democratic state.
Absolutely. That's exactly, that's what that space that the politicians have is that space where they create the differences and they become the people who will actually say that, okay, we will decide for you what is best for you. First you create the difference and then you want to decide. So that whole structure has to change, and that people, finally, it's not going to be easy. If a whole political structure has developed in a certain manner, they've taken it from the colonizer. I will keep saying this. This decolonization is the biggest thing for me. They've picked up the whole system from the colonizer. Our laws are what the colonizer gave us. Our civil procedure code is 1908. We got independence in 1947. Can you imagine? We stuck to that. Our Indian penal code. Just guess what era Indian penal code is. Just a guess. Just one.
1895?
Very close, 1860. Oh. 1860. We have taken what the colonizer gave us. And these people have benefited from it because the structure was made to rule over a majority by a minority. That was what the whole system was. And they picked it up. They said, why should we change it? Perfect. It suits our purpose. Give enough discretion in the civil procedure code that we never get stuck. We'll find some way out of it. We'll have this appeal and that discretion and everything. So everywhere it happens. But the only thing what has happened, Patricio, is I can see, look, I do not have any problem of time ever. But the only thing is that with you might have, and we moved away from the foundation, from the fellowship. So briefly, if you still stick to it, so my title of my mediator experience stays all right.
But we talk many things that in general tends to be with our experience, of course. But in the fellowship, can I tell you about, I can tell you the fellowship, it's something that changed your life. It's a life-changing experience, of course. I encourage people to apply, but you must take it. When I received the email when I was awarded the scholarship, it was something that is what's sticking in my mind, because this is a bet. It's an investment. This is not a holiday. This is not a vacation. This is a job. Yeah. And you must be realistic. You must be realistic, because during the time frame of the scholarship, you will be allowed to participate in something that is most of the case cannot in your life, the possibility to see this institution working and creating unsolved problems that we can eventually never have the opportunity to know or to say how it works. And the most important thing that we must understand is this, to take ideas, to talk about with other persons. Eventually, you cannot think that you will stay in contact. The foundation always have interest that you become engaged with them. It's interesting, but at last, this is a bet and a thing that you must do in your own country and generate networks in your country and with other fellows. But sometimes, and it's also important to take in consideration that maybe you have a vision and you think you go in one direction, but you cannot control the life. So eventually you may change your decision, or you may change because reality change. For example, I'm very interested about environmental mediation, which is something that has been engaged in doing research about this issue. But for the things of the pandemic, for other aspects, I've become incorporated with a group of friends of people to create an NGO where arbitrators of insolvency law to promote the insolvency law in due the economical effects of the pandemic. And it was very important because we discovered that there's a big problem about why arbitration is not used and why it's necessary to implement or give more space to ADR in insolvency law. Because it's more efficient. Yeah. And something that was unexpected for me, but reality moved me to accept this challenge and to generate this NGO and to promote the arbitration and promote the ADR in insolvency law. It was expected when I made the scholarship, but changed it. What was really important is all the tools, all the mindset and the interactions that allow you to analyze a problem and to promote something in order to create a culture of peace and a culture about the AD where ODR is more important than litigation, or it's just a new alternative, something that you create, as I mentioned before, something that you, it's a way to promote democracy, fairness and justice. Without a vote to court.
Only thing, Patricia, let me tell you that the A word is not used on my show. Never. Arbitration is not used. That A word doesn't come. I used it because I had to tell you. I just stay away from that. I said there will never be mediation and arbitration not to be discussed together because there's so much confusion. I'm just saying there's so much confusion that today also, the worldwide, people still don't know. They still connect the two for some reason.
Yeah, no, but it's completely different. But for example, when I back to my country and I did a lot of arbitration during the last 2 years, and it was an experience because it's also important to it's an issue for all the program or other aspect. But arbitration also it's not a fairy tale or it's not the promise that give you more solutions. Eventually, it's the same structure that happened in the courts. But if you are shrewd enough, if you are creative enough, if you create rules in arbitration that allow people to settle, to be the parties, the more important participant and the protagonist of the process, this allow you to create an arbitration very similar to a mediation, not being a mediation, but to promote the settle, the direct settle, is something that helps you, yeah? If you want to replicate the logic of confrontation, it's something that's not useful. But you incorporate this new coordinates, eventually may obtain something better.
No, I think, look, finally, it all comes down to developing that culture of mediation and people. So collaborative dispute resolution is what they have to understand themselves, which is why we have to work, Patricio, at the grassroots. We have to start from the grassroots, which is what you, with your experience and obviously your experience in healthcare and the other experiences that you've had. I think you need to also be out there in the world in helping people set up systems like that with the entire family mediation, that whole system that you people have developed. But Patricia, what you haven't taken us through is what was the plan that you had when you applied for the fellowship, what you did in the US, and when you came back, what did you do using that information or the knowledge that you gained?
Well, I was really interested about the dispute decide system. I was really interested about this issue with Jan Martinez. I have the opportunity to assist to lectures in Stanford University, Professor Jan Martinez. And yes, it was interesting because I take course in Hastings, which is ADR associated with how to implement system of ADR with some degree of relation with courts. And I have made a lot of shadowing with many mediators in the headquarters, in the office of JAMS in San Francisco. And most of the experience allowed me to see, for example, how is the management of the cases, the management of one mediation, for example, the art of the phone calls. Something, it was really important for me. How do people in JAMS, because when you arrive to JAMS, don't think that you will have a great office or a space super special for you. No, if you go, you must understand that we are going and we are allowing to enter in a very professional organization, but we have a limited space. We have a very limited context and we must be very respectful about the hard and delicate work that is done in JAMS offices, yeah? But when I was working or doing research, I hear, for example, how the assistant made the phone calls. And it was something, that's something absolutely amazing because how they convince the people to become to mediation or how they give information. This sort of tips were important for me. For example, other issue is the ability of some mediators to prevent or to understand or to have a preview about the amount of money that will be where the dispute will be settled. It was something really interesting. And after that, what I did in my research was the dispute design, and it was interesting in ODR also. Yeah, it was an opportunity to participate in a course of ODR. And after that, when I back to my country, I become interested or trying to apply this these techniques, particularly in ODR. And at last, it was possible, but more than a legal chain throughout the pandemic. Pandemic allowed to make and perform and to do ODR in Chile. So that was the my path and my application during the scholarship and after that.
But any specific, you think, experience that you want to talk about, something you thought was, I mean, something which felt good, or some people that you thought were some way people who helped you in whatever way?
Well, one of the, all the team of JAMS, it's wonderful. Above all was, for example, Ellen Bass. Ellen Bass is the person who is in charge of the scholarship, particularly. It's one of the most interesting people who helped us in very administrative and during the path. And it was absolutely amazing how their patient that she has that helped us to make this experience successful. Of course, the benefactor, Daniel Weinstein, it's a personality. It's something amazing how the things that he did and how all these people generates this culture. For example, other person that it was really remarkable for me was Jay Welsh. Jay Welsh is one of the leaders of JAMS. And something that it was really interesting for me, it was how they started to promote with the insurance industry. So it's important to become engaged with the community of insurance, and throughout the linkage with insurance industry, they started to implement mediation. Other person like David Brandon, for example. David Brandon, it was amazing how being lawyer and people that come from one of the finest university in law, which is Berkeley, like Ellen Bass, for example, he decided to go to mediation because it was something that fit better with their own personality. And the flexibility is something that this example, it's very inspiring for you because you can recognize thing that you are at you thing, but never have the possibility to confront from an external point of view.
Yeah, that's why I say that's why these experiences and why that's why I'm talking to you about these, because these are finer things which get missed out. I mean, the very little things that you experience, which can change your life also, which teach you about a lot of things for people's experiences. I think that's very important. So then you came back, and then you immediately, how did you implement what you had picked up from there?
Well, I think that the implementation, it's related about the methodology of job, how to approach and to analyze the problems. This is something extremely important. The pragmatic point of view, something that it was very interesting, and also how to implement the implementation, and it confirms the implementation is not easy. It takes time, but you make to have a strategy and follow this strategy. And if this strategy, it doesn't work, okay, you can change it with some degree of adaptations, because reality is something that you cannot control absolutely. So this is the most important lesson that I learned during the scholarship.
Interesting. Well, that's why I'm saying, I think this, with you people giving your experiences, it can inspire people. A lot of people can be inspired. And it's not just a matter of the fellowship. It's beyond that. I mean, to be inspired in terms of the profession, which is what I said. And for me, what I picked up was that I need to get a lot of people to whatever, however I'm going to do it, let's see, whatever. But before, what I'm going to do now, Patricio, is I'm just going to take you off the things that are happening in December, because I'd already, while you were gone with your internet connectivity, I went through the November thing. So give me 2 minutes to go through that. So basically what happened in December is Harbey was on the 1st of December.
Yes, I saw.
Very nice conversation. I really like that conversation.
Wonderful.
This was on Saturday. This is that In Conversation with the Beautiful Mind. Just a conversation about, she's in a small town in Russia, in Barnaul. It's called Barnaul. Wanting to create a community mediation center. So she's also applied for the JAMS Fellowship. And of course, that fellowship, whatever is going to happen, but I'm trying to work some way that we can develop that community mediation in Barnaul. Yes, this person you recognize? Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, myself.
Louis, he's coming on Wednesday for a lecture on mediation. He's going to give it in Spanish and in English. Anna is in the US. I don't know whether you've met her or ever spoke to her, but she's also a wonderful person. She's going to talk about her thing. This is what's going to happen on Wednesday. There's other things in December. I'm not going ahead. Yeah. This is only the first 2 weeks, but I put this out on the third week also. So he's coming in. Very interesting work. I think what work they are doing there, what is it called? Pro-dialogo or something like
that? Pro-dialogo. Yeah, pro-dialogo. Pro-dialogue.
Yeah.
Pro-dialogue. It sounds good. Yeah. It's no problem.
But really, I think what they've done, been able to create, is not bad at all. I mean, really something which is a model for a lot of countries. So definitely. Yeah. So yeah. Patricio, any closing remarks, anything? Oh, Judge Weinstein, I've called him, I've invited him for that show, Evolution of a Mediator. That's going to happen. Yeah. He's going to come on in January, 15th of January. He's on that show. Yeah. So right. But that show is to go into a person's life, right from whatever, they're even there, grandparents, their life and all that. So that's a very involved kind of show. So that's going to happen then. Yeah. Perfect. So any concluding remarks, anything that you want to tell people, inspire them, whatever, please.
Well, I think it's important to be patient. If you engage in ADR, it's something that takes time, but you must be consistent. You must be strong enough, because sometimes you feel that something is not going as fast as you go, as you want, but it's something that you must prevail. If you have, it's a wonderful possibility. It's very narrow. It's an area of the law that it's growing. It's not decreasing. It's more always increasing the possibility to implement ADR to different areas. So it's something that I can share with you. And above all, give the thanks. And this scholarship is something that you must be very grateful. It's a life-changing experience. It's be a part of this community. And of course, if you apply, it's not easy, but you must be very clear about what you want to do research. And if you don't achieve it the first time, go ahead trying, because it's something that it's worth the value all the time. And if you are awarded with scholarship, you must be grateful for your lifetime.
Okay, and thank you very much. And let me also put on finally, the JAMS fellowship application is over. The 19th of November was the last date. But if there are any projects, I'm telling people, if there are any projects that you have in mind where you must send them to me. I'll see where we can create resources, get people together, and we will try and take up those projects from wherever in the world. I think that's going to happen. But on 16th of December, that is when there's some interesting announcement I'm going to be making, some things that I have planned. So I'll send you the invitation for that. Please come in. It's at night. It's at 10:30 India time, which means 4.5 hours after what we started this one. So it's not good. Yeah. It's going to be maybe in the afternoon for you. So you have to come in. I'll send you the link and all. Yeah. So thank you very much, Patricio. Very nice of you do this. Thank Wonderful you. Conversation. Really enjoyed it. I mean, so
a lot. Great. Really, really. It was a pleasure. Of course. Thank you for having me, and thanks for your generosity and your hard work. And of course, I expect that this will be not the last, will be the first of many other conversations. And if you are interested or you need any collaboration, please do not hesitate to contact me. I will be happy to collaborate with you.
Absolutely. Perfect. Great. It will be wonderful collaborating with you. So I'll just end.